6:30, so it's time to call the meeting to order. Let's start with Pledge Allegiance and a moment of silence.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, thank you. All right, the first things on the agenda are the consent items. We have the minutes of the May 23rd regular meeting. We need to certify those minutes of the June 6th executive session, minutes of the June 6th board meeting, and the minutes of the June 6th study session. It's a big day. Board, do we have a motion to approve those?
So moved.
Second.
All right, motion by Jenny, second by Brad. All in favor, raise your right hand. Passes 5-0. Okay, then we go on to the financials, and that's Val.
Good evening. In your packet are the financials for this evening, or for, I'm sorry, the month of May. For the general fund, pretty much everything ran as normal: salaries, wages, benefits, operating costs, and supplies. Out of the general fund, that total for receipts, I'm sorry, let me bump back over to our beginning balance, was $256,235.68 with $988,835.34 in receipts. Our month-to-date expenses were $963,349.40. Puts us at an ending cash balance of $281,721.62. Any questions on general fund before I move to debt service? Okay. So debt service, we started off with $1,381,804.04. Receipts included property tax replacement credit revenue that we had gotten in the amount of $23,088.27. No expenditures. Our debt service is due this month for the month of June, so next month I'll have those debt service payments to report. Our ending balance within the debt service was $1,404,892.31. Any questions about this one?
I have a question about the general.
The general? Okay.
Yeah. What did you say the cash balance was?
Cash balance ending was $281,721.62. So we're still on the amends from a 3-pay payroll month back in April. So we're catching back up and building from there.
Okay, all right, thank you.
You're welcome. Capital Projects Fund, pretty much everything is normal. Technology salaries and benefits, a lot of our software licensing and building repair and maintenance comes out of this fund. We started with $480,297.74. We had $12,144.94 in as receipts that came from property tax replacement credit as well. We had some facility rental too that goes back into capital projects to maintain the buildings and pay for those, some of those utilities. Our expenses out of capital projects totaled $41,109.26. And so that leaves our ending cash balance as $451,333.42. Any questions with capital projects?
Well, this goes with capital project and general fund.
Okay.
For the year-over-year comparison,
mm-hmm.
we are doing far better, more than $600,000 better in capital projects and
right.
not in general. Are there some things that we were taking out of capital projects that we are out of general fund now? Or, I know you weren't here last year, but
mm-hmm. That's a great question.
For what, why are there those tendencies?
Yeah, it could be a lot of technology things for once. You know, our devices, maybe a lot of that came from technology, or I'm sorry, from capital projects last year, whereas this year we found, you know, additional funding sources to alleviate that, bring us back into, you know, this positive balance, you know, in comparison to last year. So just being more mindful of opportunities to get capital projects fund back where it needs to be to be responsible with funding from there.
Okay. But not necessarily, it's not necessarily a trade-off of one or the other?
No, we get funding from Ivy Tech. There's, you know, there's a lot of different things that are out there for opportunities and funding. I think Ivy Tech pays us rent for using part of this facility. So there's a lot of different things like those moving pieces that when they do become available, it's, you know, assessing and evaluating when and, you know, what and when each opportunity would be best to take advantage of. Kind of fitting together a good puzzle.
And one of the that we saw in the general fund was the late release when the state released teacher data late. And so we had that back payment, retro payment that was due to teachers. And so we're still, rather than that being divided up from August until today, that was divvied out in one large lump sum. So it's cycling ourselves to catch back up from that.
And we absorbed the insurance costs increase last year.
We did. We absorbed the entire.
And had a raise.
Yep.
Modest, but a raise.
Right.
Thank you. Great question. Thank you. Moving on to transportation fund. Also pays for salaries and benefits of our bus drivers, repairs and maintenance on the buses and supplies. Our buses in safe operation started at $756,718.60. We had $5,717.77 worth of property tax replacement credits. Our month-to-date expenses were $67,619.51, leaving us an ending balance of $694,816.86. Any questions with transportation fund? Okay. Last is bus replacement fund, $233,946.82. I'm sorry, wrong line. $232,516.49 was our beginning cash balance. My apologies. We had property tax replacement credit as well in this fund in the amount of $1,430.33. No expenditures. There are some potentially forthcoming with, you know, replacing old buses, and Mr. Ward will have more to say on that as the time comes, but he's in the process of switching out some old buses and getting some new replacements in there, which is what this fund is for. So no expenditures. So that leaves our ending balance as $233,946.82 from there. Any questions with this fund?
Any other questions from the board before we vote? Do I have a motion to approve financials as?
I move to approve the financial report.
Do I have a second?
A second.
Second by Jenny. All in favor, raise your right hand. Passes 5-0. Okay, we've got a list of donations. I've got that somewhere. Thanks. The first thing on the list is from Psi Ota Xi, Columbia Summer Reading Program, for the kids to have 72 books. Very generous. Target donated $16.63 toward high school student activities. Olive Branch Church of God donated time to work on cleaning and disinfecting iPads and covers at Columbia. The Rochester Optimist Club donated to the Middle School National Junior Honor Society Washington DC Trip Fund, $500. And the Wellness Center donated to the middle school aqua equipment and 8 pairs of fitness shoes for student needs. Is there anything to add to the donations list? Did I see something? No. Okay. Do I have a motion to accept the donations?
So moved.
A second?
Second that.
All right. Motion made by Brad, seconded by Don. All in favor? Passes 5-0. Okay, and policies and procedures. Let's see. We are Jenny and Jana and I are working on finding a date where we can all three sit down with Tom Keg and go over the next batch of policies. We do need to, let's see, policy on materiality and process for recording material items. We've been working on, and Valerie did some good work on that one as well. Is there anything we need to go over on that, you think?
I think it's important, I think last time we talked about the policy in general, but we didn't have specific numbers plugged in that we were all comfortable with. So Val did some research, and if you want to share.
Yeah.
I can move out of the way here.
What this policy does is, with Indiana Code 511-127, like it, you know, like it shows on the board there, requires us that we have to report erroneous or irregular material variances, losses, shortages, thefts of political subdivision. Pretty much anything that is school, corporation, property is making sure that everything is accounted for responsibly, and then putting place limits internally on behalf of Rochester School Corporation of what that limit is, that we will reach out to the State Board of Accounts, let them know of the potential loss, shortages, difference from there, to be fiscally responsible. So what my proposal was to the board was anything over $500 be reported to the State Board of Accounts. Regardless, we're going to do our own internal research, follow up, and make sure that we can get that identified. But it for our due diligence and that checks and balance piece, it was my recommendation that $500 be established as that bar. Anything under $500, it's still going to be actively pursued and followed up with from there, as far as why and what happened. But that $500 limit is what's going to trigger that initial State Board of Accounts phone call.
Thank you.
So we have three readings now?
Yeah, you need to approve and waive the second reading and go on to the third reading. So a motion to approve it for all three readings would be appropriate.
We can do that. Have a motion.
Okay. Yeah, with unanimous consent.
Okay. Do I have a motion to?
Just a second.
Okay.
A resolution like this, we had discussed at our study session, is not necessarily something we had to do, because people who did the resolution entities that did the resolution said we're going to pass this policy, and then later passed it, mm-hmm. Weeks later. We need to do it all tonight, so we don't necessarily need a resolution to adopt a policy and then adopt a policy. Is that
right?
Correct?
As the resolution says, this is in fact a policy. So that's.
So by passing, voting on this, we are passing the
policy. You are passing the policy. It'll
okay.
Get added to the policy manual. But changes to policy or additions to policy do require, under the parliamentary rules that you operate under, a three reading process.
But we can.
But you can bypass it with unanimous consent of okay. Members of the board.
Does anybody on the board have issue with combining all three?
Normally we would, and we discussed this in depth at our study session a few weeks ago. Due to the time constraints that this must be passed by the end of the month, and the fact that we did have Val do her due diligence in researching this, and we had those in more in-depth discussions at study session, that we felt like
we can.
It was still a valid process.
Okay.
Ted, if we pass this, that Val has it. I mean, we have these NEOLA policies that we were going to fold this into.
Right.
Does it need to be something separate, or?
This supersedes the NEOLA policy because we haven't adopted the NEOLA policy yet, so we'll just pull that out and this will go in.
Okay.
In lieu of?
Okay. Because as part of the, there's a difference, as you see what Lisa's holding in the NEOLA policy. But we have put into these that same threshold of $500
right.
to. Activate that State Board of Accounts. Thank you. Sorry.
Sure. No.
When everything's done, you should give this policy the same number as what the NEOLA has.
It would be 6111. And there are quite a few other policies that this fingers into, and so there are actually 6110, 6111, 6112, 6114, 6116, 6320, 6325, 6460, 6550, 7300, 7310, 7450, and 8500. So we will need to go through those, but most of those were just minor tweaks.
This was very much like the gang policy. The state gave us very little time to do all of the steps that they wanted to get it within the timeframe of when board meetings are scheduled without creating a special board meeting just for this, which is another reason for the sense of urgency.
Okay, do I have a motion from the board?
I'll move that we pass this financial accountability policy because of the time constraints that the state put upon us and because there's nothing really controversial about this. Because it's a financial protection for the corporation, I move that we pass this with all three readings this evening.
Do I have a second?
I second that.
Seconded by Brad. All in favor, raise your right hand. Passes five to zero. Okay, I know a lot of people have worked really hard on the parking lot layout. Who would like to talk about that?
We have Oscar and Skeeter and Jim here. I know that Brad also sat in on some meetings with us, and it's our intention to try to come up with a new plan for travel within the parking lot. Would just gently remind everybody that the problems that we continue to run into is that we're landlocked there. We can't build a parking garage or have these great escape routes for people to come and go. So the team has formed and considered several different plans and options, and Jim brought some really good information to us that wasn't considered in the original conversations in regards to how this would work in the wintertime and everything. So with the three of them together, Oscar, we'll turn it over to you and to Skeeter as to the recommendations and try to start communicating to the public, because this is going to take not only our understanding of, but we're going to have to do a lot of advertisement around this so that as school starts in the fall, parents and student drivers, employees as they're coming in and out are mindful about what this is going to look like and the intentions for it, so.
Viridian sent us a couple drawings, and then we sent those back, and they sent us these four that we narrowed it down to. Two of them deal with angled parking, and two of them deal with 90-degree parking. And when you talk to individuals like Skeeter, even Jim had some input on that, and Brad and other people that we've talked to, the 90-degree parking, it causes a lot more accidents. So we instantly eliminated two of the four options because it was 90-degree, because they are identical to the angled parking ones, just instead of 90-degree, it's angled. And so then that narrows it down to two, which if you are looking at the drawings in the bottom right corner, it says drawing numbers, and that's C2 and C4. And the big difference is the direction of what the angled parking goes. C2's up now, that is the north-south angled parking. You just changed it on me. Okay, so there's the north-south angled parking, then if you scroll all the way to the bottom to C4, there you go. It is the east-west angled parking, and now I'm speaking as the middle school principal here. What it does is when you look at the left side of the drawing, it still has the two lanes where our parents pick up the students. It still has the two walkways that our gentlemen will still man and make sure that students are not getting hit as they're walking out. So I'm in favor of this one as the group is as far as C4 goes. You see the angled parking, it's a lot different than what we have currently. You can go both ways, it alternates each way. We used to only have one point of exit. I think Brad calls that egress. Now we'll have two because the north lane will now be two directions instead of just one. We've removed the handicap parking from right there beside the sidewalk, and it's here, and it's right there by the two entrances as far as Zevi, and then also the football entrance as well. So we still have all that handicap parking as well. I can't remember exactly how many spots were currently there until they resurfaced, but now with the C4, you'll get 413 standard and 24 handicap parking spots. I believe that is more handicap parking and maybe just a few less. I know when we talked with Jim, a big concern was in the winter, the south side there is where they push snow, so those spots you see at the bottom.
South side, right?
Is that where you push it, Jim?
Right there.
So we may lose some of those during the winter months if we have a big snow, but we do that currently now anyway. And if we get a real big snow, they make piles up there on the north side too. It's just part of what we deal with, and Jim and the guys do a great job. What else did we have in as far as
that? Well, I mean, that's fine. Like I said, you're going to lose the south and you're going to lose the east because we push everything to the east and roll everything to the south. You're also going to lose some handicaps. The handicaps, where they put these handicaps, they need to move them because technically the entrance to school is up right there. And I can't see putting handicaps that far away from the door. I thought handicaps would close the door for the handicapped people. See what I mean?
Well, but the football gate that they would use...
Well, the main football gate's up here on the east end.
Well, but on Fridays, we use that one down here. And then over here, the basketball handicap over there where our parents pick up, Scott, is so they can go into the...
By the Zebby doors.
Zebby doors. So, I mean, we can make them over there as well.
I'm just saying, most of the people go in the east end.
It really wouldn't be that hard for them to adjust those spots.
You can move them down
to your basketball.
I mean, it's two scales, so you're going to, which leaves one side.
You also need some handicapped outside, because you only have two there at the middle school driveway.
Uh-huh.
And there's none out there where people go in for your ball games.
Well, that's all we currently have with the current layout, too. So
for remarking, it would be nice to have a few more up there where people can park and walk across.
Have you considered the ones we put down by the pool that haven't been there in the past?
Yeah, but who's going to park down there except for pool?
Baseball.
I'm going to tell you, there's a lot more basketball games, volleyball games at the gym than there are pool up means.
Once again, those could be shifted down somewhere to the north side fairly easily.
Or half of them.
Maybe half of them. Jim, those ones on the corner, I know that they kind of look out of place sort of there, but when we talked about earlier for baseball games and things, I think that that's kind of a difficult venue for people to get to, especially folks that would need a handicap.
Yes, it is.
So maybe we could leave three down there and move another three down closer to the main entrance of the middle school, you think?
Yeah. I'm confused about how the traffic flows. Could you walk me through that a little bit? Thank you.
When we talk about, like at the track, we talk about areas of egress. The more areas of egress you have, the more you can get people out. Because it was one way only on the top end, when we got people out of school, we had one area of egress because the bus lot's over here. Originally, that was supposed to be only one way because we sent the buses down here up to 16th and out, and it would jam traffic up. We don't do that anymore. We send them all out the west side, so we just gained a point of egress. By making that two-way traffic, people could come in and go out or go out down here. We've doubled our egress, so in theory, we've doubled our amount of people we can get out in the same amount of time. Or shorten the amount of time to get the same amount of people.
How does that work though, Brad, with these parking spots that change? How
right
do they
here,
get out of
just
there?
Like it was in the past. This is, if you can see, it's two-way here. Uh-huh. There would be cones right here. These people would all leave out of here from the middle school. Okay? This still would be still staying one way. But anywhere on this side would be two-way out.
So that solid line, it looks like to me, is not really a solid line.
It's not
line.
A barrier, I don't think, is it?
No.
It's just,
so
it's
people
a
do can move from there.
Yes, they can go out this way. Like if they're coming out this way, it is two-way traffic, because the concern I had from the public was, if we go in, we've got to go all the way back down around and come out this way. You go that way, then come back this way, and go back that way, and come back this way. This is two-way, this is two-way.
Okay, so if you get to the end, you know, if you're coming in for a basketball game or something, and you come down the second
right here.
Line, and you get to the end and there aren't any spots,
right.
You can turn around.
You can turn either left or right. It's a two-way traffic, uh-huh. Judging by the others.
Okay.
And that's part of what Jana was talking about with the educating the public, because that's been one way for so long, we'll have to have those arrows in white. People will have to pay attention, but so far, knock on wood, I hate to say this publicly, but we have pretty good drivers.
Well, it's not, honestly, our parking lot right now is hard for people
right.
Who haven't been here before. Anyway,
how many times do you see people driving down there the wrong way anyway? Sure. And maybe that wasn't my place, but as part of that, I wanted to make sure we understand the functionality of it.
I appreciate that. Mm-hmm. I just couldn't tell if it was a barrier or not right there.
It looks like one functionally, but really it's going to be a white, bright white line that people are going to drive across anyway.
I have high hopes for this.
Well, I'm talking with Adam, and we're going to try and keep the high schoolers up in those two sections. Maybe they'll have to use the bottom, top half of that one. And so if they do exit that way, you see, I mean, where those handicap spots are, parents won't be parked in those. And so those high schoolers can still go up and out. And then we're going to encourage the high schoolers to go out the north exit, and our parents are going out the south exit. And so we divided and conquered, hopefully, alleviate a lot of our traffic concerns at the end of the school day.
And we do like the angle parking, like you said, because it reduces, in theory, the amount of crashes rather than 90-degree parking.
Thank you, gentlemen, for all that work. Do we have to do anything to go forward as a board? Do we have to?
Yeah, since you're changing the parking program, you get on the board people.
We need to vote on that?
You vote on it.
Okay.
And right now, you've got two choices to make. I don't know if you've got a recommendation.
I like two and four. Mr. Oz said he likes four. I don't think either one is a bad choice. But then again, like Gina said, we're landlocked. It's not like we're building parking lots around the school or in the school.
I know, it's real paper. I made real paper and cotton paste today.
So there's nothing else.
Can we need an ordinance to put a stop sign down on that? She's been.
Yeah, is there going to be a stop sign?
It has to be.
Down here?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
That's going to border right out Pontiac.
Yeah, the board will have to approve a stop sign there, and there's probably an agreement they need to come to with the city so that the city can enforce that as necessary.
Right.
We talked about in earlier discussions, I really hope that we get enough signage. Back there, to make it very clear for people as best we can.
Yeah. Would anything have changed then at Pontiac? Is that already two ways?
No, it was. It was years ago.
And then it was changed to one way for everybody to leave.
No, Pontiac.
Pontiac's always been two way, but coming into the school was always
been one way.
It was
right.
Always an exit.
So nothing changes at Pontiac.
Well, once you turn west onto the access road there,
right.
that was one way. Now it's going to be two ways, so you're going to have a stop sign there. You want the city police to be able to enforce right. that.
So cars will be able to come out on the north side and go left or right, and cars will be able to come out on the south side and be able to go left or right. But they'll have to know that they can't go left in both lanes on the south side.
Right.
Gotcha. Right in my head.
Gina, functionally, when do you expect this to be ready to go? What date?
Well, they're doing the filling the cracks and everything right now and getting ready to do the entire parking lot. So that's why we need to make sure that we not only adopt this in time to begin painting, because that's going to be completed soon, but also the communication piece that needs to go out, because we're going to have to advertise this.
Sure.
And I know that we have high hopes. I don't know that it's going to resolve all problems. If the kiddos aren't following the walkway paths, the parents are doing what they want to do, and student drivers are cutting across three rows of parking lot and not following that, nothing that we do is going to work. So it's just going to have to be conversation and communication.
If we choose to do this and then we choose to enforce it, then they will. I mean, we have the resources to have the manpower to enforce it and they'll follow the rules. But like anything else, if there's nobody out there to enforce it, then people don't follow.
I think you need to get with the city and see if they'll put arrows on the pavement down there at that north intersection, the arrow, and we need double arrow down there also on the pavement.
Oscar, are you ready to order signs to help direct traffic? Once the board approves this, somebody's going to need to order. Know where you're going to put signs and order the signs. So.
Yeah. Okay. Valerie says yes, I am.
She says yes, she can.
I can spend money. I just don't want to get in trouble for it. Thank you, Matt.
So the way I'm understanding it, then I heard the need to rearrange some of these handicapped parking spots, making sure that we have clear signage and painting there, at the various levels, working with Skeeter and the city to make sure that we get that stop sign. We'll make some phone calls tomorrow around that in regards to that.
Since I did hear that we will still have people directing traffic, I would like, first of all, most importantly, that those people should wear vests, something bright that hasn't been done in the past, and I think that it's a small investment to make. I would also encourage whatever level of training, maybe our local police or Skeeter or Brad or someone could help give them in how to properly direct traffic.
And hopefully their job, their workload will be halved.
Oh, exactly.
If the high schoolers are going out the other way, hopefully they won't have so much.
They're dedicated people who have to stand out in all sorts of disgusting weather.
So hopefully that will lighten their load also. Okay, so how do I proceed with this?
Ask for a motion to approve either drawing two or drawing four.
Okay.
See what motion you get.
You want C4 would be your recommendation. And Brad, you are good with that. Mrs. Vance?
Skeeter.
Good with that?
C4.
Skeeter?
Yeah.
C4?
Do we address your concerns or not?
Yeah.
C4 with the addendum that we move.
My concern is concerned with that, where the handicap park.
Okay.
Right, where we move with the addendum that we move, what, six spots down closer to the east gym door and then four spots closer to the middle school main door?
Well, now you've added more handicap. Is that your intention?
Split three and three down middle school.
Right, just move whatever we got, take half of them, move them.
Have the middle school have some along the building, though.
Just two, yeah.
Just two.
So we've added some others. Okay. Can I have a motion?
I make a motion we adopt to use drawing C4, moving half the handicap spots down to the middle of the parking lot and get the appropriate signage.
Do I have a second?
A second.
All in favor, raise your right hand. Passes 5-0.
All right.
Yeah. I wonder if everybody was this excited when were you guys this excited when it changed the last time?
Yeah, but I guess it was needless one.
That's what we're going to do.
That was terrible. I hate to tell you, that was just terrible. That was terrible. I hope this is better. Very good. Thank you all for working on that. We appreciate it.
We sent complaints to.
Not me.
Yeah, we got three other options.
Brad.
If you like it.
Remember Brad.
It was their job. If you don't like it, I'm responsible.
Very good. All right. Number four, commissioning proposal for high school renovation.
We shared within the board packet the idea, having had heart-to-heart conversations with Terry Thornsberry at Viridian, and just knowing that the undertaking of the HVAC systems across our district is huge, and it's the majority of our bond monies and what we're doing. And I'm constantly asking Terry, is this going to resolve the issue? Is it going to take care of the problem? He keeps assuring me that it's going to better the situation and in all likelihood take care of the problem. And we continue to have those conversations back and forth. And I started asking other superintendents and doing some research, and I just felt a third party that could come in and double check those drawings, could double check and make sure that the systems that we are ordering and putting into place are realistic for our district, that we're not overspending, that we're getting the job done that we need to get done, that those monies are well spent. It's a checkpoint, I believe, for Terry Thornsberry and Viridian. It's also, I believe, sound investment money for Rochester Community Schools in regards to the size of the bond project that we're trying to do. We've had many, many members of the community step forward, and I very much appreciate their professional experience and level of expertise and background. And this is just such a large project with millions of dollars that we're getting ready to invest, and I just have made a commitment verbally to everybody, and I just want to make sure we're doing the right thing. So Terry and I jointly worked together to find a third party that would be willing to take this endeavor on. They gave us the first option of a contract, and I did speak with Ted Wagner, and he went through that project. They provide very good recommendations. They have done similar work for IU, for Notre Dame, for Grissom Air Force Base, for Fort Wayne Orthopedics. They have a wealth of references that are good references, viable references. Ted and I started speaking, and we thought it wouldn't hurt to extend the contract out. This is a multi-million dollar contract that's going to go over several years, about 3 years period of time, and so we propose to carry that contract out just a little bit further. In its entirety, we would be looking at about $16,000. It could be paid for out of bond monies to just provide that third party look in to make sure that Terry's drawings are accurate. He knows that it's not worry about his work. It's a checkpoint for both parties and both entities. But I bring it to you because it's not something that we talked about in the original bond monies. It's not something that we've spoken about directly other than having local experts come in, but I think that this helps reinforce that for all parties.
My question on that is, there always has to be one person making the decision. So if there's a conflict between what Jim says is right or what our consultant says is right or what Terry says is right, who makes that decision to say this is what we do?
The final decision, that's mine.
Very well. I'm okay with that.
In the event if there was litigation, then is this more finger pointing at, oh, well, they said this, and you end up having,
it's more complicated scenario?
I mean, if that were to happen, would it be more complicated then with another party?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But it would also be one more pocket that could pay for it rather than us.
We just don't want to render another honeymoon.
Right.
And I think that's what, I mean, in good faith, what I'm trying to prevent is, I am not trained in this area, and Jim has a wealth of information, but we've both spoken very openly about the kind of systems that are going in and the technology that it takes. I wholeheartedly trust Terry Thornsberry and Viridian, but I know that there's always those questions that come up, and why not, and I think that this is that third party that brings that to the table that would back us on this.
And they are then throughout the whole project, it looks like.
Yes.
Well, and if you read the first proposal, they're throughout the whole project until the project is completed. We said, why don't you give us, and they had in their list of possible events, a 10-month post-construction checkup, but it was not marked. It was not a part of what they were proposing. We said, give us 10 months, and then give us 24 months. We want you back here a couple times after it's done, after, you know, everything's gone and the teachers are past the, hey, isn't this neat, it's only 82 instead of 86 in my room. Well, by then, if it's 82, they're going to be frustrated, and we'll have people there who can figure out how to make the fix. So that's why we've got two contracts. The first was, we'll carry you through the process, and when you cut the ribbon, we're done. And we said, no, we want you there. We don't want this to be a later $10,000 contract. Now it's an additional $4,000 for the two additional checks. And that just gives us what I hope to be a more satisfactory solution.
You know, so many of those things you don't know until right. 6 months later or a year later.
And it gives time for weak controls to shake out and break. Right. You know, just because they're electronic doesn't mean they won't fail.
Is this what this firm does, or do they also do what Terry does and so on, or this is what this?
They design the electronic control systems. They do this, they do lighting, they do fire alarms, things like that, but it's all that kind of, they don't design buildings. And they're also tied into the LEED program too. You know, Terry's a LEED certified architect. These people are LEED certified for this kind of work, so.
Okay, do I need a motion to approve that proposal? Okay,
so on this contract, they don't check all their boxes in the back that they'll participate in? Right. Is this what we're voting on tonight then? Is the way it's reads that June 14th? Is that the version? We had two versions in the packet.
Right, June 14th.
The
version.
June 14th. So there's a lot of boxes that aren't marked.
Right.
And you're, we're all happy with the way that looks. I don't see the 10-month check is not marked, but yeah, then
it's back up there.
Is that an addendum that's
on the second version? It is checked.
Oh yeah, okay.
614 version.
Yeah, the front page has a red line revised June 14th.
is the second document there, Steve, on the, if you go back to your...
On the bottom of page seven. Yeah, bottom of page seven.
Yeah, I mean, this part here where all these aren't marked.
If you, under public commentary on the second form over here, and it's red on the front page.
Right. But also at the bottom of page seven, there's a line 12 in the text portion. Scott's pulling it up right behind you. Post occupancy figures.
That very last line on page seven, item number 12.
All good, there it is.
Before we vote on this, this is a company we're paying to make sure that the plans we look at are what they appear, and that the equipment will work and all this. There's double checking everything.
On HVAC.
Pardon?
On HVAC.
Yes. This is not the same as value engineering. They're not looking for ways to save?
No.
Okay, all right.
Other than to make sure that, speaking with me, that they understand our needs and our desires, and that what is being proposed by Terry and Veridian will in fact meet those needs.
All right, super. I have a question. Jim, have, page seven, item seven, it talks about testing our current setup, because it's going to be integrated with the new stuff, and they recommend testing our current, I'm not sure what they said exactly. And there's a $1,200 add-on for that. On one way, it seems like $1,200 wouldn't pay for a whole lot of testing, but on the other hand, it seems like it would be important testing. What are your thoughts on it?
Well, that should, that, whatever controls they put in have to be integrated into our older systems. Like, I don't think we're going to do all of our systems, just what the units were replacing. And I'm pretty sure what they'll do is come in and make sure that it does integrate with it. And that's probably what's $1,200, the time it takes them to go through and check all that stuff. It does not take long.
Okay.
They go on a laptop and plug into it, and a couple of minutes are done, and they move on to the next people. Sometimes they can plug in and do a whole building. So it won't take long for them to make sure that everything integrates together.
So Jana, are you recommending any of the alternates? It looks like there were two alternates. One of them was that testing of the hot water system, and another was the monitor and direct owner O&M training?
Both.
You're recommending to do both of those?
Exactly.
Okay, so that would be it.
Well, in the silence, I'll make the motion that we hire this company, and that we add on alternate one and alternate two. And that we approve this contract.
Motion by Don, do I have a second?
I'll second.
Jenny seconds. All in favor, raise your right hand. Motion passes 5-0. Okay, that moves us on to personnel. Let's see. Okay. First on the list is the approval of Greg Martz's athletic director contract. Jana, would you like to address that?
Sure. Last month, Greg was approved as our new AD. And we are proposing for him a 220-day contract, paying $70,160, and it would be the standard two-year contract for administrators.
Okay, anything out of the ordinary?
No, there's, you know, with Greg's experience, his contract is a little more than what our former AD's contract was, but overall, as an administrative team, I believe Val and I came up with $1,200 or $1,400 savings on the administrative team as a whole. So you will see that then on Luke Bernacki's contract that we speak about next. That helps balance that difference on the administrative team.
Okay. Can I have a motion to approve Greg Martz's contract?
I approve. I make a motion to approve Greg Martz's contract.
All right. We got a motion by Brad. Do we have a second?
I'll second.
Second by Jenny. All in favor, raise your right hand. And it passes 5-0. I see that I skipped over some, but we'll go ahead and do these contracts first and then go back. Okay, secondly then, that brings up Luke Bernacki's contract as our Riddle principal.
Correct. And again, we're proposing a 2-year, the standard administrative contract for 220 days, and his pay would be $70,180.
Anyone have any questions about that contract? Have a chance to look at it? No? Do I have a motion to approve?
So moved.
I second that.
Okay, and motion made by Jenny, seconded by Steve. All in favor, raise your right hand. Pass 5-0. Okay, and that takes us back up to the personnel report. Do I have that listed?
I have them.
Here they are. Okay. We're looking to approve for the summer intercession Leslie Strem, Megan Schroeder, Winnie Wilson, and Julie Kitchell, all at Riddle. This is not where. Okay, thank you. Tammy Paul and Chris Cox, Ken Hughes, and if necessary, Alan Sager at the middle school.
And Oscar, am I correct that Alan Sager would be, if necessary, based on numbers of enrollment for that intercession? It's always easy to get parents and students to say they're going to come. It's a little harder to get them through the door, but we need to have somebody on standby if we do get them in the door. We want to make sure that they get the supports that they need.
Do I have to break these apart, Ted, and do those? Okay. And we have maternity leave of Alicia Helt for speech and hearing, semester one, from August 3rd, 2016 to December 20th, 2016. Is this where I should add these in? Yes. Okay. We also have something from Pat Mellinger. Recommending Amy Bodie as our school psychologist. Would you like to say anything, Pat?
No? Amy's a resident of our community, and she's done some volunteer work at Columbia. She has 19 years experience, and I'm really pleased that she was able to agree to come. She's done some work for us, just contract work, and we're pleased with her for the way that she does it, so we're anxious for her to be on board with us.
Great, thank you. And Mr. Snyder, you have a new teacher.
I'd like to recommend that we hire Joe Clark for our first grade teaching position that we have available at Columbia. Joe is a community member, Rochester community member, and she has been with us for a year in multiple roles. She was a IA for us in the first grade. She did her student teaching in the first grade, and she filled in for the second half of an entire year for maternity leave for Sarah Downs. She did a fantastic job. Came very highly recommended by every other first grade teacher and other people she worked with in the building. And the committee, strongly recommends that Joe be our newest addition to the first grade class.
Great, thank you. Okay, do I have a motion to approve the personnel report as it's been read?
So moved.
Do I have a second?
Second.
All right, all in favor, raise your right hand. 5-0. Let's make this easy. Okay. Our superintendent, what else we have? Oh, I thought we were done. We're not. Page 2. I thought, wow, this is so fast. Janet didn't even put herself on the agenda. Wow. It is time.
Page 2. Yeah.
Oh, yes, Mr. Doherty, we wouldn't ever want to forget that.
It is time to look at Skeeter Doherty's renewal of his SRO contract. One of the very first steps that we have to do is go to the Board of Works and get their agreement in regards to an MOU, because his services, and he can correct me if I'm wrong, are a joint agreement between ourselves and the Rochester City Police, and that they still provide him hours of training. They still help provide his uniform, some of the supplies that he needs. We then pick up his salary via matching funds with grants. And so our first step was to secure that MOU with the city and the local police department, and they graciously did that again this year. The only change to the MOU that we see this year that we did not have in there last year is the flexibility to allow him to wear soft uniforms in the case of training. I know you did like bicycle safety for the younger kiddos in the building, and I think sometimes if he is in a softer uniform, meaning not fully in the police uniform, the students are a little more receptive to that training and not so intimidated. So the only change to the MOU was that. Everything else stays standard, that the city's still going to provide the hours of training, which also continues to provide him his arrest powers if we so need that. And we continue to secure grants with matching funds to make sure that we can cover the cost of his salary. It was discussed at the school study session, at the board study session, that we're constantly in this pattern of going to the city and then bringing it here. And I don't know that we can eliminate that step with the city. I think that's an important communication process that we need to do. But I would propose that we put him at least on a two-year contract, as long as, well, on the standard two-year contract. I don't know if it's something that we can make evergreen as long as the grant monies continue to follow that funding source. If they don't, is that a time to bring that up to the board? Well, I'm not sure. It just seems like we're constantly in the state of going from one to the other, and if we could secure that, I think that's something just to cross off our...
This is the kind of contract that you can only extend as long as you've got funding or reasonable expectation of funding, and since it's a grant, you have to get a grant before you sign a contract. So if you don't have a contract for or a grant for 17, 18 year, then you can extend it for 16, 17. You can't go to the second year yet.
Do we have a grant through 17, 18, or do we know?
It's on a year-by-year basis. I know it's how the state operates it through the Department of Homeland
Security. Oh, I'm clear.
Just to put it on the record.
Me too.
Not that the board doesn't want to, but you know,
okay.
You can only
okay.
bind yourself to the money you've got available.
But can we do it if?
Did you look at the general fund balance before you do the if?
No, are you saying that if the grant funds goes away, then we
if the grant continues the second year, we're going to do it?
No, you can do it if you've got the money pledged. You can say, if there's no grant, we will take it out of the general fund. But
we can't do if the grant proceeds, we're going to proceed. We can't do that now. All right, thank you.
Nice effort.
Okay, so it looks like we're looking at a 1 year. The only difference is a soft uniform at some times, rather than his full regalia all the time. Okay. Do I have a motion to approve the renewal of Skeeter's contract?
So moved. I'll second that.
All right. All in favor, raise your right hand. You even got some from the background. That's good. Wow. That's really good,
six
Skeeter. Yeah, six and a half. I think I saw another one back there.
I've known Skeeter forever, and I don't want to make this meeting last any longer than it has to, but I think it saves A, the city a lot of time, and B, a lot of time, and it puts more of a person out there that the kids can connect to, and saves us all and helps us all as a whole. So.
Yeah. Gives the teachers back some of their time and our administrators too. Yeah, great. Thanks.
Thanks for adding.
It's public too, Skeeter.
All right, now we're at superintendent business. You're not going to be
working. No, we are working on the IA, the structural pipeline, which we'll bring to you in the July meeting. I know that I have met with Val and with Brenda Troyer, and we want to make sure that we rectify the concern that's been going on in regards to the IA pipeline and the inconsistency that's been happening. I shared with the office staff there at Central Office my four non-negotiables. One was that we needed to rectify the current concerns. We wanted to maintain fiscal responsibility. I've talked to the administrative team. We know that we need to force the administrative team as well as the supervising teachers into an evaluation model for all of those employees that fall on that pipeline. And then also to provide the administrative team within that evaluation a bit of flexibility for job performance and experience and longevity within the district. So I believe the central office team has come up with that. I've shared with the building level principals, and they're still looking over that and thinking through how that might look within their buildings. I want to connect with them just one more time before we bring it to you for approval, but we're very close to having that issue resolved, and I think, I'm hoping for everybody, will be a win-win situation. I think principals understand the purpose behind it and think that it can be very beneficial moving forward. A special thank you to the transportation department and to Kevin Walls-Kong. He did all of the driving for this weekend for the power show. I only heard good things about that transportation and the fact that Rochester Schools was able to help support that. I don't know, Skeeter, if you have anything that you want to add to that in regards to...
Kevin did an excellent job. He met all the needs of the campers that were staying at the fairgrounds. We set up a tentative schedule, but Kevin varied from that just to make sure people got in and out. If they wanted to be back, if they got sick or just tired, he'd take them back. He was there all the time. And, he took care of them very well. We appreciate what he's done.
As we talk about busing and transportation, two unique things have happened. One is that through the Chamber of Commerce, Amy Rowe did a wonderful job in setting up a meeting with Superintendent Linda Ritz today, Brett Boggs from Tippecanoe Valley, Cindy Douglas from Caston, and myself were all able to sit down behind closed doors and just have very open, honest conversations. And it's really interesting to sit down with her one-on-one and ask those tough questions around federal funding and how that affects rural schools, especially those that the border are areas that are much smaller than we are, and as you're seeing with our general fund, and she most certainly understands that. We talked a lot about how that she had very specific information in regards to how many millions of dollars are spent on charter schools, those types of things that are being taken away. And I would just encourage everybody, as we go into the next elections, that you pay very close attention to what legislators are saying and their intention of how they're going to support school districts, especially those at the local level, the rural schools, and how that funding is going to affect us. She had some very interesting funding formulas that would be quite helpful to rural schools and allow those communities to still embrace their students and have that school within the community. She had really interesting information in regards to parents that choose charter schools or private schools automatically get a $1,000 tax deduct to pay for textbooks. We are only one of, I believe, 8 states in the nation that continue to charge textbook rental, yet public school parents don't get that tax deduct. So she has some really interesting ideas around public education, and we haven't had a chance to speak to anybody else. I am not here to promote anybody. I would just encourage you to pay very close attention as to what they're saying and how that's going to impact all schools across the state, especially us here locally. As we talk about that, I sat down with Cindy Douglas, and she's very much aware, as is the administrative team. We are running a bus into Fulton starting this fall. It'll be a pickup at the Grub. We already have that aligned. I've asked building level principals, I'm having conversations in Argus tomorrow around that. We really need to be tracking that. We're not committed to running transportation there, but if we get that level of interest, we will most certainly entertain that. So it's difficult. It's really difficult to sit down within the same county with superintendents that care just as much as we do about kiddos, and then have to tell her we plan on running a bus, and she knew very well that was coming, and I'm certain that a bus will come this way too. And we're trading funding, but we're impacting communities, and we just need to be very careful around that and just know when we place that vote what that really means. And as we talk about textbook rental, we'll bring that to you hopefully early in July. Maybe we can hit that before our study session. I put the challenge out to building level principals. We know that textbook rental will come in at the same as or less than what it did last year. And I commend them for continuing to really look at what we are using as opposed to what we just continue to charge families and what that looks like and is it necessary. Jason had some wonderful ideas around that in regards to reading that Val and I need to sit down and talk about. Oscar had some ideas with his change in the master schedule, what that might look like. So in good faith, I can tell parents it will be the same or probably less than what they paid last year, but we really want to dissect every level of that textbook rental and make sure what we're charging is what's actually needed. That being said, our next study session is July 13th at 8:45 at the admin building, and then our board meeting has been changed and graciously changed by the board to July 25th. I'll be out of the state on that regular board meeting day for family wedding, and so I most certainly appreciate your support in allowing me to attend that event and backing that meeting up. So we've kind of staggered those to hopefully get done the work that needs to be done to start the new school year and be ready to roll that out, but graciously allows me to attend my family wedding in Tennessee, so I appreciate your efforts in that. And if there aren't any questions, I think.
Anything else for the good of the order? All right, can I motion to adjourn?
Thank you.